Yogendra Singh ji, very close friend of mine, Professor Anand Kumar ji, Professor Pramod Yadav ji, Professor Ajay Patnaik, and I could see many friends, faculty members and students. It is honor and privilege for me to be in a chair when a stalwart like Professor Yogendra Singh ji give a talk. I don't know if it's a coincidence or blessing. This is the third talk I'm chairing, and Professor Yogendra Singh was giving a lecture. I'm blessed for that one. I am in JNU for last 41 years. And I thought that I will also narrate some of the incidences. Except at the first part of appointment faculty and other things, I am involved everywhere. And so he has not left anything for me. But I will mention one or two, three incidences. Definitely the first thing, let me start from 1983 incidents. There was a stone throwing, windows were broken, and I was traveling from Maharashtra, and my train came very late, and morning when I came, my house was almost open. So when I entered in, and I was about to clean that one, so many students from, I was warden of Sutlej Hostel, and there was another two hostels, you know, around. They saw me that entering, the 10-15 students came running. They were like, sir, you don't clean, we'll do that one. So this is the student, those who also involved in breaking the windows, and same people, student wanted to come and clean the warden's house and remove those. Yeah. Another incident, sir has mentioned about there was no hierarchy. There was no hierarchy when I joined the faculty in life sciences. And in 87, I became a chairman of the admission committee. I was assistant professor. Then who were my members? Professor Shutosh Mukherjee, Jan person in zoology. She one of the senior most professor, joined with Professor Yogendra Singh. Then another professor, Shipra Mukherjee. I always introduce her as a father of tissue culture, because she developed the tissue and plant tissue culture. And therefore, I always introduce her as a father of tissue culture. So they were the members of my fund. When I told them, sir, I told either Shipra Mukherjee should become chairman or Professor Shutosh Mukherjee should become chairman. No, you be a chairman. And we were surprised that they work like a member. And sometimes I used to get a phone call from them. Shipra Mukherjee was staying in number 10 and Shutosh Mukherjee in number 1. In the night while preparing the question papers, Kali question ho gaye hai, nahin? Then we will walk. Both of them sometimes walk down to complete the quota of zoology in plant in the night at 10 o'clock, 8 o'clock. And I was when I preparing the questions for the examination. So there was no hierarchy as such. And also there was no also formality in something. I will give another incident. I will indirectly touch the topic. I think 1978, there was a lot of flood in Maharashtra, in Godavari, and that boy didn't get a either telephone call or a letter for coming to the JNU for examination. But somehow he got my name, that somebody from Aurangabad, and he came here, searched me, and the next day I took to Center of Political Studies. Professor Bhamri was the chairman at that time. Now, as you know, very hilariously, he didn't tell directly that it is not possible. You know, he was telling that what the procedure and other things, and he said, no, according to rule and regulation, it doesn't work. I told, sir, whether the rules are important, if you see your action, then I started talking as a student of JNU. So I told you, you see your act and the purpose for which the university is built. I think rules not are very important. Because this is a person coming from the remotest part of the country where even the letter cannot go there, the telegraph cannot go there, and your admission policy and other thing that we have to, our catchment area, so we should go to the remote part of the country and get the people in JNU. And so you are defeating your own this thing. Then it becomes seriously, become a lot of seriousness will come after 2 days. But in between, he asked one faculty to interact that boy. But he didn't tell anything. After 2 days, again I went. And he told me, seriously, sir, he told Kale, he is a teachable. He has a problem of language, but I think we don't test for language, we test for knowledge. And he was admitted after 3-4 months, which is not possible now, because it's just a bureaucratic process. There are so many things to tell. And I think what the impact JNU has made. The Professor Yadav has mentioned that JNU was a model for the other universities and UGC. Yes, that is true, Hyderabad University. But it was debated to some extent when the 16 universities were established in 2009. And I was one of the vice chancellors of that university. When Professor Swaraj gave the presentation in the PMO's office, and they decided to start at least one central university to the state where it was not there. And when it was decided, then what kind of the model of the university? They said, what is the success story? This was narrated by Mungekar to me in UGC when he addressed as a new vice chancellor. And there was a discussion which is what is success model. That was nobody, none other than JNU. And so they wanted to establish all the 16 universities on the JNU model. It's not only one or two, it is not only a guiding factor. And it was my stay on this one, it was so easy for me, though it was a new university, so many constraints, but I said very well, and Professor Yadav is witness for this one. So JNU, so this is impact HRs. Now I will go in a indirectly actually, because since Sir has nicely detailed way he has mentioned, but I reminded, first I thought I was confused what I should speak, but because whatever I prepared is gone waste now. So I thought that what, then I reminded his speech indirectly. I can think about two countries, Japan and America. So why Japan become developed? And when I think about develop, I don't only think in terms of GDP. It's also social development, multiple poverty index, and what we are nowadays thinking, where we stand. So from that perspective, we see how Japan has become a developed nation. And it's only because of education. And this is started from Meiji's period. 1910, Japan was completely literate. It was far ahead in Europe and other countries. And because of that education foundation, Japan had progressed that way. I'm making a long story short. Then I mentioned about America. Perhaps you may be knowing, and I hope my memory doesn't fault me, the first PhD of America, USA, was not from American university. It was from Germany, because America was so educationally backward. So it got a help from France to get liberated from their own people. They fought against the British and became independent. But as far as education is concerned, they took help of Germany and sent hundreds of students to Germany. They went back and they helped in developing the education system, and we know where now America is. And if you see from that perspective, and if you come and see the what happened in India, I will see the example of failures actually. Since I am from science, I'll give the example of science. You know, P. Ramarawa, who was a secretary of our DST, he was a vice chancellor of Hyderabad University, where he renowned scientist, Padma Bhushan, and he was the chairman of our 11th plan to sanction grant from UGC. He was here. And that person has, that is his quotation, this is information. When he was giving a talk in Bangalore, in V.R.K. Rao's Institute, he was talking about the technology used by India. What he means is there, the 50% technology is imported, we do not make any change and use it. Okay. Another 45% technology is imported, we do a cosmetic changes and use it. We only develop here, make or manufacture whatever it is there, in only 5% technology. And see how many technological institute India has built. And solely for the purpose to develop in the technology and make a nation independent. Okay. So we are, this is totally failure. And still, and you see the how much money we are spending on the technology, importing technology. So, academic, the purpose for which such institutes were built, they have completely failed the nation. Okay. Now we come to the general education like JNU. If you go from Radhakrishnan to very latest one, Eshpal, our knowledge commission, what we see, I see only five important objects of our education system: access to education, quality of education, education equity and equality, and you should have a relevance in life. And if you see this kind of, whether we are able to provide access to education, whether we are able to give the quality education, whether the equity and equality, and whether it has a relevance. If you see these five terms, important objects of this one, I see our where JNU stands. JNU has provided access to everybody. Sir has already mentioned, I think the best diversity is found in on this campus, in teachers and students. When I was doing up the student, UGC wanted to develop a diversity index to grant a grant on that basis. After the, which is at the minority committee commission report, they suggested that the grant should be given depend upon the diversity index. Higher the diversity index, more the grant. And that time, Professor Chadda was the chairman of that committee, and then suddenly asked me that I can prepare some document, background paper, and see that how diversity can be achieved on the campus. Only JNU has done, they have done this one actually. So that time I did analysis actually. Whatever the 10, 15 years that I had, and all complete diversity. Education, background, economic, whatever the income and other kind of things. And I found that it's a perfect the reflection of the country, and in this country. And most diverse campus on this one. And this is one of the reasons why we excel in the academics. And that time I told also the such kind of diversity can contribute the excellence in academics. And therefore, from that angle in education, I think we excelled very well. Now, what is the difference between other universities and our universities? As a student and teacher, what I found. So I came as a raw person, I will say that one. I read here and there, but I don't know. But I was not able to difference what is information knowledge and how it is correlated wisdom other things. Because I came as a student. But on this campus, then I know that what campus taught me that scientific scrutiny, that I learned here on campus, logical questioning and critical evaluation. And unless you have this one, I think you don't learn this one. And this campus has taught us actually. And another thing, will to win. Very lot of confidence is given by this campus. And personally, I have that experience like that. And no parallel like that. Now you take any field, as I said, I indirectly mentioned about this. Whether you think about foreign policy, I think we are the pioneers in foreign policy. And our logo also shows that. You see the logo which shows as the rosebud as a representing Nehru. There are two globes of the earth and interaction. This is international interactions. There's a international relations and interactions. And through that one, we have to generate knowledge also. I think this is a place I was able to understand what is the knowledge. And I tried to, whatever I learned here, to extrapolate to my university. And as far as the impact of societal impact, whether students went to the bureaucracy, went to the media, and I know personally, because I have seen a fourth generation students, and when we travel everywhere, it's really very, very positive impact. It is very difficult to quantitize. Suppose you take education as such. If you go to any university, I went to Darbhanga. I found a lot of JNU students there. I went to Hyderabad University. Lot of people, students are there. And they are molding the education actually. Now we started semester system, credit system, and very recently UGC accepted it. This is another big impact on the education society, education. The JNU has made it. I think there is no any sphere of the life of the nation where JNU has not impacted. And we can see the visibly. I think I'll be, as a being a person from science, if you can quantitize this data, I would have been very comfortable to tell you. And that's the reason I give the example of indirectly or directly tell the how education is important for the nation development. And without education, and that's the reason I keep on telling, India is still educationally backward. See the percentage of the hour. How many people go to the higher education out of 1.25 billion people or 1.3 billion people? Not more than 2%, not more than 2%. My rough assessment, though people are telling that is a 22% or 3% GRE is there, but my rough calculation, and I know I was involved in some of the policy making, so I feel that how we stage the figures and show the data, but it should not go beyond the 19%. That means 1.9% people of the total population in higher education. And we think about becoming the developed nation. But as far as the JNU, if you see from that angle, and JNU has given the quality education, not just in numbers. And Sari has also mentioned another point, the humanization. I think you are from, most of the people are from social sciences. I did not talk about this thing, but you know the generally brain behind terrorism. They are all technocrats. Most of them, almost exclusive. Yeah. Why it has happened? Because they are working in such a circumstances, in the course of time, they get dehumanized. They don't have value for this one. Yeah. And that is the reason many times we say that social sciences should be part of the technical education. We tried in IITs, but the people who are working in such kind of subjects, I think they are secondary citizens in IITs. But it is very, very important. Yeah. And such kind of, the JNU has an interdisciplinary subject. I came from very hardcore science. And then suddenly I saw that, yes, I also started understanding social science and political science. That credit goes to interaction outside the class as a student. And then I started telling my own student, in JNU, you may not learn in class, but definitely you learn outside the class. So, and this is a uniqueness of JNU. So we have bigger class actually outside. We learn their real human values. We learn of our country. We learn our culture. And how to stay together. And what is the national integration? I learn in the hostels and campuses on Dhaba. That time, I know from social sciences, my student, because I also little bit active student. I was the first time election commission member. Then second time when I became election commission, somebody forced me to resign and contest, I become councillor. And meanwhile, framing of the constitution of our union, then become warden, provost, and then proctor, chief proctor, dean of the student. And I also, from the very early age as a teacher, I also work under our with him, Professor Yogendra Singh, in several committees. And that interaction teaches more. And in the case of JNU also, the administration and governance, there's a lot of participation of teachers. It's not just like a headmaster, he's heading, doing the everything. The moment institution can get converted into the school which is headed by the only headmaster and he runs this one, I think that institute is collapsed educationally. You can only teach a student, he will answer the questions, he may get a 90% marks, but I think he will not be real what we wanted. And here only I learn as a student what is the research. So I always keep on telling my student, and I also try to implement in Gujarat University when I went. Well, we have to make some contribution. Whatever the knowledge is existed, we have to take it forward or create a new knowledge. So this is exactly what happens here. So other places, If you see that in science particularly, and I have seen in the very nice institutes, the JNU students who are done here MSc and they're going and doing PhD in institutes, and see the students who are done PhD from life science or other place in a JNU, I find a difference between these two. They come as a scholars after getting PhD, and the student from the institute, they come as a technician. And there's a lot of difference. And you know, one student is sufficient to change the history of the nation. One scientist is sufficient to change the entire science, world of the science. And that's the reason I have hope, as Sir has mentioned me. We are doing our own bits. And small thing, whatever it is there, and we continue the value of JNU. But definitely, if not individually, but if we try to assess for 50 years of the contribution to JNU, to the nation building, and if you do a proper scrutiny, and you will find that, I think it comes on top. I still remember when the NAC team last time visited. You know, this was the biggest team visited our place. The Professor Ranganathan had treated each school as a one university and made a team, and himself came over here. He had so high regards for this one, and he always used to tell me, because I know him from, because of Professor Rao, he knew me. So I think JNU and Delhi University have, this should have been the first universities to undergo the NAC accreditation, and that would have become a benchmark. So what now is we see that everybody gets A plus or A plus plus, or whatever it is there. And this kind of thing will not happen earlier. And therefore he was very happy when JNU applied for the NAC. And you must be, I think there were more than 30 people. I came from Gujarat here, I was with him. He came personal to, though he was not a coordinator. Coordinator was somebody, Professor Mr. Hegde, Dr. Hegde. And he told him, what is this? 10 volumes of your this one. See our publications, the documentation you have done. And you know what is the importance of the documentation in terms of publication books. I think no university has done. And this remain as a guiding star or guiding factor for generation to come, whether you are on campus or you will not be on the campus. But whatever the knowledge generated and published in the form of the books and publications, and this will remain as such and go on growing. That it was 10 volumes of our, I think 10 or 5 volumes, very big. This was the only very, very big actually the kind of information were given to NAC, and he was surprised. And, so we have very uniqueness actually. If you see the small thing and keep together, and then we see that what the university JNU is very different. See, and when it comes to matter of the perception, I think everybody has issues, and it is not necessary that perception should completely overlap the reality. And any media or as Sari has mentioned, there is also perception of JNU that depends on the person who is perceiving that one. And I think that part, I do not have a control how somebody will pursue. But as long as we are here, and let us think in that way and keep the JNU what JNU is. And as such, there is no change in the value, whether it's 1970 or it is a 2017. I'm witnessing that those values from 1976 I'm also formally superannuated. But still, JNU is such a big attraction, it's very difficult to do. Myself and my children were telling, sir, daddy, how you go and how you stay outside? And your entire life, means 41 years of my life spent on this campus. And when I went now, now around this one, I see that world is very different. Because JNU is different. And those values, I think we should cherish, we should keep this one and continue it. If not really feasible as such, the kind of thing or theme Professor Yadav and Professor Anand Kumar ji has mentioned, directly we are not able to address what is the contribution of JNU to the nation. But I think it, if not feasible, but we can fill that one. And JNU has, whatever the good things in academics, other things we see, I think it has immense contribution. If you go to the ground, we feel it. And let me tell you, I will not name the place on this one. But there was a, wherever I go, people say that your IS officer and IPS officer are very different. Anybody can go and meet them, unlike others. I have seen some of the IS officers, IPS officers, the riot had taken place, there's a problem, they give their personal phone number to them. Don't worry, I'm here, you make a call to me, I'll be at your service. This value only emerged or taught from this one, and that credit goes to the founding faculty of this university. So whatever they have made a foundation, keep it intact and build as good building as possible, and that I think it will outcome to stage. At the end, I don't know I was very qualified for this function as a chair, but yes, it is an honor for me, and for that one I am immensely grateful to Professor Anand Kumar and Yadavji, and I cannot say no to them. When I first time same thing happened one day in 90, I think there was some debate and discussion. Arun Kumar ji came and said, no, we have to come at 9 o'clock and you have to give talk. And so I was in my, we were neighbors at that time. So he has not given me an half hour, 40 minutes also. He couldn't understand, I'm not, he's a very different person. He has left science long back, in after BSc. And still I'm in science. But anyway, I think I'm happy that he takes liberty, whether it is a success or failure on my part. But thank you very much for inviting me. And thank you.